women really have a tough time, maybe the women's movement would be more useful. However, that doesn't mean that I'm a Rush Limbaugh. The first woman, Bethel woman that I'm going to mention tonight, who was of standing and importance real the first 50 years of this century here, was Cleo Russell, who was Bethel's postmaster from 1922 to 1935. And I was delighted to see that her obituary in The Citizen, which Stanley had copied for me, referred to her as the postmaster. Because it's the job that counts, not the gender. And in the years when I was working as an ambassador, people would address me as an ambassadress, usually some ignorant tourist. And I would point out an ambassadress is just a wife. An ambassador is the one who did the job. And the authority was that is given to the French Academy, which spent 30 years discussing whether it was Madame la Consule or Madame le Consule, and they came to the conclusion it was le Consule, if she herself had the job. If she was just a wife, it was la Consule. Anyway, Cleo was the postmaster. She had been born in 1881, moved to Bethel in 1891, was educated in the Bethel schools and the Gould Academy, as they always say. She worked in the post office from 1907 to 1918. She then worked in the National Bank from 1918 to 1922. And in 1922, she was named the postmaster. Now, at that time, postmaster jobs were given as political patronage. In other words, the political party of the president determined the political party of the postmaster, though it usually took a year or two to catch up with it. And in 1920, Warren G. Harding had been elected a Republican, and Cleo was a very strong Republican. And I assume that certainly that was why a Republican was named. And I don't know she was exactly, if no one will ever know what goes on within the Republican inner circles of this town or any other, but it must have reflected the fact not only that the Republican president, but at the end of World War I, women had received suffrage, and from the moment women got the vote, even though it took some time really, from that time on they began to be noticed by politicians. But basically she got the job because she was very competent. I don't think there was ever the slightest question. And I never heard anyone, even my mother, who was a very strong Democrat, never failed to express it. I never heard anyone refer to Cleo in the derogatory terms that were sometimes used about political postmasters. In fact, my mother was extremely fond of Cleo, to say that political differences never matter. She was outstandingly competent, and her selection was very much justified. Now, at that time, the post office workers went to work at 6 o'clock in the morning, and they worked until 6 o'clock at night, 6 days a week. And there were three of them at that time in the post office, which was roughly where the liquor store is now, which is right next to Cat Alley. It was a building on the attached to the present drugstore building, but was not part of the drugstore. There were three members of the staff. There was Cleo, and there was Ida Packard, and it was Henry Flint. I guess Henry Flint was the second in command. Cleo had, in addition, she was a supervisor. She had the financial responsibility. She had all the paperwork to do, and she had the basic responsibility of running the post office. But in addition, she took her turn at the window, and everything was done by hand. You know, they stamped every postmark, sorted mail, and did it all. We had very good service indeed. In fact, at that time, there were several deliveries of mail to Bethel during the day. Not only was there the up train and the down train, but there was something they used to refer to the stage. It was a great disappointment to be discovered just an old automobile. Anyway, the stage would come in from time to time, and we were all very happy with our mail service, which is one of the differences between now and the earlier part of the 20th century. She was a very reserved, capable woman, But she was a very, very kind woman. One of the stories which we know about, and which always everybody in the family liked, Cleo, both my mother and father, as well as the rest of us, there was a family upstairs over the drugstore which had numerous children, and at one Christmas, which was a hectic season, they were waiting and waiting and waiting for the package. You see them over in the post, just waiting and waiting. And on Christmas Day, when my mother was out, she saw the mother. My mother asked how was it. Oh, they'd had a lovely time, because night Christmas Eve, after the post office was closed, Cleo had come up late to check for that package. It was on her mind. A late stage had come in, dumped the package at the back of the soldier. So she had, of course, found the package, called him up, everything got under the Christmas tree, and it was the traditional happy ending. As I say, that sort of thing, she was very kind about indeed, and was basically an extremely popular and well-regarded postmistress. She made a great impression on me. In fact, although I deplore the use of jargon like role model and that sort of thing, in a way I've always think Cleo had made a great impact. One of the things I'll tell you, they used to be traditional at that time. You had minstrel shows and local shows. And the pattern was that the people running the show, they'd buy an old copy of Captain Billy's Whiz Bang, and they'd pick several jokes, the more or less repeatable ones, out of them, and then they'd ply them with local names. So somebody would say, "Have you heard, Mr. Bones, about what happened at Louis Ramsell's store?" And he'd say, "No, what did happen?" He'd say, "Well, Susie Russell, who was the wife of Frank Russell, the superintendent of schools, Susie Russell called up to cancel her order for hamburg because the cat had caught a mouse." And everybody, I mean, people weren't as delicate as they are. Well, it was a period of time in which it was very, very common, very usual to have jokes about old maids. Cleo was a spinster. Old maids under the bed, all this sort of thing. All women were supposed to be dying to get married. Cleo was the most prominent spinster. One of the most prominent bachelors was Fred Merrill, who worked in the bank. So in every one of these jokes, there'd be a wild hoot of laughter, and then the key lines would be, "Cleo Russell and Fred Merrill," you know. And I said to my mother, "Doesn't Cleo mind that?" It seemed very good. Oh, my mother says, "What does Cleo care about that bunch of drunken half-wits?" My mother was a great friend of Arthur Herring. Nevertheless, in a way, we miss Cleo. future date. Scholars are plowing around trying to figure out aspects of Mr. Bingham's impact on Bethel, that they will have this particular shred of evidence. Not that scholars have shown much interest so far, and one of the people in the NTL 2 years ago wrote a history of the NTL, which had an opening chapter upon Dr. Gehring and Mr. Bingham, which was conspicuous by its inaccuracy. I think the basic role of the book, of course, was not to discuss that. But anyway, this is to put it on the record. She had come to Bethel as a nurse. She came from somewhere in Massachusetts, as we say vaguely about that area. She married a very prominent local man, G.L. Thurston, who was one of the six Thurston brothers, many of whom had exotic names, but G.L. his name was Guy. Betty had a lively and charming personality, and she fell very naturally and easily into this role of being assistant to Mrs. Gehring at the Gehring house, dealing with the guests and so forth. And during the winter, she and G.L. lived there all year round. It was a matter of great relief at Bethel when sometime in the early 1920s, the Gehrings and Mr. Bingham began to take off for Florida in the winter. It's very impressive. Mr. Bingham had a private railroad car, which people who took care of Mr. Biggins went in and spoke to Mr. Biggins, and within half an hour the telephone call had been made to Boston and the operation was taken care of. That's what they, Mr. Biggins would leap to do, because it was exactly the sort of thing that appealed. Well, there were a certain, always, it was taken for granted that, and you could guess and do that, always in a poor community with a very, very wealthy man living there, requests were made either directly or indirectly for assistance. The major advisors of Mr. Bingham on his financial matters were Dr. Farnsworth, who was Mrs. Gehring's son, but I don't know which related ones, and they were not easy to deal with. I don't know anybody locally that ever liked to deal with them. Two occasions my father had ever dealt with Dr. Farnsworth in respect to them from the hospital. Dr. Farnsworth wanted you to understand that he was very, very important. And that sort of slowed things up, to put it mildly. Man from all over people. But if the request did trickle in, Betty was the one that was sent out quietly to find out what is the, who are the people, what is needed or necessary. She would appear at 9:30, quarter of 10, which was late in our household, and she and my mother and father would creep off into the doctor's office and whisper that. I suppose she had other people she consulted. She certainly consulted the other doctors on various cases. And she would have consulted various teachers. One way or another, she must have had a quietly. Everything was always done very quietly, and everything was always done with complete anonymity and secrecy. We don't know ever who received assistance, and we don't know who asked. The only person who ever told me that he received assistance, and he volunteered it, I guess he didn't know how situated, was Ed Muskie, who told me when he was here in 1974 that he had applied when he graduated from Bates, he wanted to go to law school. And someone said, why don't you write to the rich man in Bethel? And so he had sent it off as a, and he had received, Mr. Bingham had given him the money to go to law school. So. But basically, it's much better that no one ever wants to, anyone else to know they've asked for charity. And Mr. Bingham, of course, didn't want anybody to know he'd given it, because that would have opened the floodgates. But it was always my mother, and we do know that some people certainly got it. And it was always my mother and father's belief that, to the extent her position allowed, and she was a very loyal person, these requests Betty would have handled with sensitivity and kindness. She was a kind woman. She had a wonderful personality. Gella once described her to my sister as being goddamn fascinating. He said in relation to this, he'd been saying that she'd worn out, tell you, running around with some of the women from the inn who were bored and wanted something to do. And he said she couldn't get out of it because they wouldn't leave her alone. But she did have great gaiety and spontaneity. As I say, she just had a wonderful personality. And I remember once my mother went, there was a trustees, local trustees party at the academy, and I guess they were having it in the girls' dormitory because it was spring vacation, right around St. Patrick's. My mother and the doctor went on a sense of duty, and the following morning we asked my mother how things went. She said, well, she said everybody at first was very stiff and on their good behavior, but it started out pretty grisly. She said, but pretty soon Betty and G.L. came. Betty got all the old men singing Who Threw the Overalls and Mrs. Murphy's Child Up. And even your father had a good time. And she said, they all loosened up considerably. And she did have that impact. I noticed her obituary. I think it showed, it was a touch that my mother might have made. And my mother wrote so many obituaries she might have written. It ended up and said, Betty loved gardening, animals, children, and grown-ups. She had a happy and satisfying life of service. And I think that she certainly did well by the town to the best of her ability. The next one I'm dealing with is someone who is known probably more teacher said, had anybody ever known Ethel Bisbee? And I said, well, yes, you could, even at this stage of the game, you could go out into Bethel and find everybody who started school who's still alive after 1916, and believe it or not, some of us are still alive. You could find a great many people who knew Ethel Bisbee. And let's say that, and she knew every one of them. I don't think there's any question about it. I encountered her in 1925 when I went to first grade at Crescent Park. We were the first grade at the Crescent Park. That was when it opened. And I remember her very well. All sorts of things were wrong with it from the standpoint of modern teachers. First of all, there were 40 children in the class. Yeah, you were there, weren't you, Darrell? I don't know. No, you're the other. Anyway, there were 40 children in the class, which is at least twice the limit that you should have. When I taught at Bowdoin, I felt very much amused when I had 19 people, that's about it, because 20 is just about everything you can take. And there were no teacher's aides. All of the work of taking the boots on and off and that sort of thing, though I might say not all 40 needed that, only about 10 or 15. I would have died of mortification if I had needed my overshoes on and off. She did that. That was part of the job, along with, let's say, the 10 to 40. And the class, after two or three days, I don't know what the organization was, we were divided immediately into A, B, and C classes, with A being the brightest and going down the line. I think that is considered very poor today. You're supposed to call them robins or bluebirds or something when you do it. So I'm willing to bet Bethel would have arranged the robins or bluebirds. The robins would have been bright on the bluebirds. I mean, she would have done it that way, because I don't think in the 47 years she taught that she ever changed, particularly her basic methods. But to say we divided in the class on the basis of ability, which was taken for granted. She was almost the perfect picture of a school teacher. She was slim, trim, extremely neat, meticulous with fine features. She had magnificent posture, lovely, erect posture, very ladylike, and rather soft, clear voice. And many, many, many little girls held her up as the ideal for the first grade. I wanted to teach, but I wasn't keen on the first grade, even at that point. I liked her very much. I liked school. And she ran a very orderly classroom, and I remember it very happily. Most children, I think, like an orderly classroom and remember it when they know what they're going to do with everybody. She was very businesslike, very efficient. And I can see now, in the A class, about four or five of us, when we came to school, already knew how to read. In those days, there was no such thing as daycare, and you stayed at home. And very often, your mother or your older sister or someone like that taught you to read. My sister used to play school, and I was the victim, and I got a very good grounding in it. And Barbara Moore also knew how to read. She was an only child, and her mother taught her to read because she had one child to take care of. She was bored, so she taught her to read. Your high school teacher read. And it wasn't at all uncommon, as I said. I don't know whether it's approved or not today. I think that, but anyway, we all know how to read. The system they were using at that time was that you taught people to read by phonetics. You taught them this, they broke a word down, and they used a symbol for every syllable, then they put it all together and you knew the word. Well, for those of us who knew how to read, Ethel didn't pay the slightest attention to that. We already knew the word. Why teach us this method of learning it? And we really knew how, because, I say, my sister had been working on me for a couple of years, and Barbara had been reading, and there were several others. I think Rita also read very well, too, because she'd had young aunts who taught her that sort of thing. And as I remember, most of the people in the A class learned to read quite wasn't one of those things. However, in the meantime, off in the background, we've been listening to the C and the B class work away on phonetics and working it out. Now, all of that, no matter what, I would be prepared to bet, I would make a this is a very serious wager, that the percentage of students who came out of the class with a very decent foundation to go on was certainly as high as the ones coming out of the first grade around, not just in Bethel, but in most places today. When we all reached school academy, and probably about 70% of us who started in that class did reach school academy, there were no remedial reading classes. Mr. Hanscom would have, well, I don't know what he would have done, but nobody, when you came into school, you knew how to read. And all of us, in one way or another, received a decent foundation, and most of us went on to graduate. Some of us, of course, didn't, but that I think happens probably in every system. So I would guess, as I say, that some way or another, that the percentage was just about as good. As I say, Ethel didn't change her tactics. I know that one of the teachers has talked with a retired teachers meeting after Ethel had retired. And Ethel had said, well, you know all this stuff about new math and whatever they tell them. We really just keep on doing what we've always done. And that was consistent with her personality, and I think that it's probably to be expected after someone's been teaching for a number of years. It was a happy classroom, and I think the majority of children absolutely loved it. Discipline was firm and quite, I don't remember any dramatic episodes. Rosalind told me that in her class, which was a year ahead of mine, Bob Brown, who was Beanie Brown, one of his second set of twins, was very active, so Ethel had tied him in his seat. She had to let him go because his twin, Roberta, always known as Sis, had cried and cried and cried, so she had to let him go. And then there was an episode again, which I don't know because of it, but the time Ethel worked and struggled and put the boots on, finally got the boots on, and turned out that it went to boys' right feet, right night boys' boots and all. So, but they were evident. But she loved all the sort of things, so she certainly, I think she genuinely did, because children could tell that she faked it. The Christmas tree, the valentines, the hanging the May baskets, all this sort of thing, which at the age of six you're not very sophisticated, but a great, great enthusiasm. And apparently, her neighbors would like to very much say that she loved that all her life, and she loved it genuinely. The first grade classroom, I think, was undoubtedly the center of her life. It may, in a way, have been a certain refuge. Her husband could be mildly described as difficult. Certainly his disposition didn't improve with age and illness. And I said to my mother one day, my mother had, you know, my mother could give a pungent speech. And she said, I said, why does everybody dislike Mr. Bisbee so? And she said, good and sufficient reasons. So I think that for a happy, pleasant, woman, the first grade must have seemed sometimes a happy and pleasant place. It was certainly the center of her life in Bethel, and everybody remembered her warmly at that time. It was, she had a very good character, you know. She was extremely feminine, and femininity, and let's say, seemingly slightly submissive, and as I say, the absolute picture book of a school teacher with everything so neat and so meticulous and so everything like that. But she had a strong character. She must have had a very strong, fine character. And her dedication, not her assertiveness, if anything, she wasn't assertive, this dedication to that work certainly gave her an independent position, which will be remembered in Bethel long and warmly. So, well, the last first grade she studied must have ended in 1962, so there's a long time before anybody can say who was Ethel Bisbee, really, and not have it understood. Though it does make me sad to think that, in a way, the school wasn't going, you know, well, people in that one room schoolroom would compare us favorably to. I'm going to conclude with talking somewhat about my mother, and I'm not going to repeat what I've said before, I hope, about her work as the doctor's wife. She was extremely important in his practice, not just as a support, but in a practical matter, and she was extremely important to many of his patients. She was also a woman of considerable talent. Her book about her family, Land Under Heaven, about the family in Aroostook County. My mother's grandfather had been one of the settlers in the area, which was fought over between the British and the Americans during the, argued over, since they didn't really fight, but he was one of the people that had been claimed by both sides during the Aroostook War, and her roots there went back very, very deep indeed. It's a book of which we're very proud, and it has been quoted in anthologies. The part she wrote about the coming of the Swedes to New Sweden was in one of the anthologies about May. And so she had real talent and ability. But what I'm going to talk about today, my mother would be the first person to say talent, ability, if you're born with it. I mean, she would have said it. My mother had excellent health and high energy. There's no doubt that was a great contribution to her success in successful living. Plus the fact she had a very quick mind. But she reminded every one of us practically from the day we were born, you don't ask to be born with a quick mind. You don't ask to be born with the sort of health she had, or the high energy. This sort of thing is something which is given to you. So she was very firm on that. Only thing she was vain about, vanity, was her excellent eyesight for many years. All of us who had poor eyes in the family, that was supposed to be from the Tibbetts. Church, the ladies' club. To listen to my mother organize a church supper, she could tell you the size of every bean pot within the congregational parish, and exactly what was, and the size of the pie plates too. Some of her comments about so-and-so would have a wonderful pie plate, and so-and-so would have a small one. I mean, mother just knew it when she began, and she'd do that sort of thing. But she did that sort of thing with pleasure through the years, and it always irritated her excessively that the ladies' club had made so much money that the deacons wanted to decide how it was spent. She stiffened the spine of some of the ladies in the ladies' club to get them to be able to get a word in edgewise on it. The other thing which she did, which was outstanding importance, was she taught Sunday school in the community. She taught Sunday school for 20-odd years. And I think that was important because it was practical influence in many respects. I have been astonished, so to speak, over the years by the number of women who have told me about the impact which my mother had on them in Sunday school. Because I never took Sunday school that firmly, and I didn't really have it very long with my mother, and what she was talking about was often what I'd heard before. Mother was very, she didn't pay much attention to the lesson, the folders and things they sent out. She'd always read it and throw it to one side because she said there's very little relation to Bethel. But she was ahead of her time in many ways. She talked about she was an organic gardener and an environmentalist long before it was fashionable to be so. She talked about these things and she talked about it intelligently because she was a marvelous gardener. And she had a very, very keen understanding and appreciation. She was a long before merely heard of Norman Vincent Peale, of whom she did not have a high opinion. She thought that he was very trifling, as she put it. But long before anybody heard of him, she was talking about the necessity of meeting life with optimism and courage and doing something. Don't let yourself get it. That was always her message. She always talked to these people, these girls, filling your mind with something when you're young, getting varied interests. Because when you're old, you don't have the energy and strength to make friends and develop new interests. Do it when you're young, but if you get interested when you're young. And she'd point, she'd say, look, so-and-so, he, all his life he worked with his hands. When he was healthy and strong, this young, this was easy. But now he's old, he's bored, he can't do anything except sit on the drugstore steps to talk about what it used to be like. That was the sort of thing my mother would do, and a lot of it, I think, sunk in. At least this I have been told. She could communicate very, very well, and yet she was not a Pollyanna. I don't want anybody ever to think this, but she was very realistic. She used to tell me, and she certainly told other people, never try to fool yourself. Never, never try to fool yourself. Look at the situation. If it's wrong, and you know it, don't tell yourself it's right. That sort of thing. And all of that, as I say, sunk in. She was helped by the fact she was a communicator. She was helped by the fact that she was extremely entertaining. Whatever she did, she could make a trip to up Broad Street to look at Betty Thurston's garden and come home by the golf course. She was always interesting. You could go off, you could go down to dig in the woods, whatever you did, my mother made it interesting. She and my father loved to prowl the woods, or when he went out at night, the doctor always liked to take mother along because she talked so much about the things that they saw along the way. Be sure she'd keep telling him not to run into a deer or this and that, and watch your driving, et cetera, et cetera. But all of it, as I say, was always, always interesting. And she could do that. She could, she read very widely. She was very fond of reading. And she talked to the girls about reading. Don't fill your mind with trash. Read this. Go to the library. Read that. And she'd talk about a book which they should be interested in reading in such a way that they might be interested in reading it, which is not always easy. And as I say, she had the very, very lively and gay personality, all of which made it much easier. Even in the house where the family grew up, it was all, mother was always very busy, and she was operating all these women, the patient wives, and so forth, my father's patients, some of them would come in and visit her. There were always the country women that came in, was one from every section of the community. And when they visited the kitchen while my mother went around doing the work right and left, every now and then someone would say, can I peel these apples or this sort of thing, but basically they just visited, and the mother would keep on doing the work. But when we'd come into the dinner table after they'd gone, I remember, this was typical, Sophie Connell, who was Dennis Wilson's grandmother, had been visiting. My father was always interested. He said, well, what's Sophie have to say? Oh, my mother said, hijinks in the Irish neighborhood. Hijinks in the Irish neighborhood. And they should talk about the hijinks in the Irish neighborhood. Every neighborhood has its resident comedian. There's always one fellow who makes the wisecrack at the Grange Hall supper that just sets the evening afire. Or there's somebody who gets the girls laughing and getting so, you know, every neighborhood has a friend and comedian. And mother would pick up all the news and do this sort of thing. It was always, as I say, though she was realistic and always, she had a lively and interested approach. And as I say, she could communicate marvelously with people, and that made a great help as a teacher. Sunday school teacher, rather. She was always in dealing with people. And this was also part of it. My mother was always helpful. You hear a lot of talk about support groups. I heard of them last night on the TV. There was a support group for older grandparents who were dealing with grandchildren and so forth. And it said that there's nothing this group can do to help, but it helps them to talk about it. My mother would have stormed. If you were a girl who graduated and didn't have a job, wasn't feasible to go into the mill, but didn't have a chance of going to college, you didn't know what you were going to do, if you asked my mother, she'd sit right down, she started canvassing the options. What about, would you try to train for a nurse? What could you do? And very often, you could find something you could do, not perhaps what you wanted, but something about it. She always felt very, very much that the teachers at the academy, those days there was no guidance, really, counselors or anything like that, she always felt that the teachers fussed too much over the good students, like me, who didn't need any help. But the teachers never fussed over the people who were just sort of ordinary and who really could use some guidance and help. And she was not just talking about it. She'd go over the application forms and help you fill them out. She'd get the letters of recommendation. She'd write one letter for her signature, then she'd write one the doctor had to sign. We'd type it or something like that. Then she'd get them all lined up. And then she'd talk to her. Now maybe you couldn't grade for hers. Maybe you wanted to go in the wax. Something of that sort. She'd go down and talk to Bill Myers, or someone who had worked at you, and she would help. Mean really help. Maybe for something as simple as a child. I was there one night and a boy came in from the academy I didn't recognize. He wanted a subject, he couldn't think of one thing to write a theme about. And he'd run in my mother in the drugstore and she said, well, let me get him 5 minutes to think about it and then come over and talk about it. And so they sat down and talked and then he had a subject, let him go home and write the theme. All of this sort of thing that she could do and would do. She really, as I say, what she, job applications, letters of recommendation, going over your options. It's a lady down the street, finds herself in middle age, what they call a displaced homemaker today, which is she has to make money and she's been nothing but a housewife all her life. She's very depressed, she's only in elementary school education. She doesn't dare ask the people in the bank for help. Sit down with my mother and go over it. You can do it. What can you do? How can you do it? All right, they decide she's an excellent cook, excellent housekeeper. She's cooked. She can do it. Well, how will I know about it? I don't know anything about money. Well, my mother wasn't good. We work out a system. This job for your taxes. This job for your utility. This for this. All very simple and easy. And in those days, they used to use 50-cent pieces. This was well before 1963 was when they made the Kennedy 50-cent piece, the 50-cent piece. But it used to be very common in currency. Take every 50-cent piece and put it in the job for taxes. When you have so much, put it in. And then go to the bank. This system now, this is ludicrous to the wise guys from SCORE and all the people who tell you how to set up a business. I could name 50 businesses that have done less well in Bethel than that particular one. Two boys graduated from college, and their mixing spoons were worn out, and absolutely, and from the moment she started with the baked beans and the pies and so forth, it worked very well. And the system with the job, 50-cent pieces for the taxes, and this 50-cent piece for job, so much for utilities, and this one for this and that, worked very well, very simple. But this is what I mean, the encouragement. Now, my mother doesn't deserve any credit for the business because the woman was an excellent cook and a fine person. My mother does. she'd been so kind to them and to their wives, that sort of thing. All of it, and I think that had an impact. I think it certainly had an impact on the people concerned, but I think it made her a very much a person whom everybody knew. Now, looking at all of these ladies at the end, I don't know what exactly what you see. You see women who, all of whom, were willing and able to work without question. They all accepted their role in a masculine-dominated society. At the same time, it didn't get them down. They didn't let it in any way. My mother was an individual, and she was an individual the day she was born. She was an individual the day she died. And right straight through, they were willing to work. They looked upon work as their opportunity to exercise influence. They wouldn't have expressed it that way. But if you weren't willing to work, you shouldn't have any say in things. And I think that they were widely respected for it, and I think they did have a considerable impact on the community. Thank you very much.